What's up, you beautiful bastards? Hope you have a fantastic Thursday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show. And a quick note before we get started. This morning, as promised, I posted an extra morning news video, this time on the EUCD Article 11 and Article 13. The subject matter is incredibly important. And so after today's show, just consider it like an extra 9 minutes of PDS. I'll include a link to it down below. But with that said, for the Thursday PDS, let's just jump into it. And the first thing we're going to talk about today is Gwyneth Paltrow in the news, since this week she is the reason why you may have seen a headline including the words vaginal egg lawsuit. To start this one off light. If you don't know, Gwyneth Paltrow has a lifestyle website known as Goop, which by the way is one of my favorite, oh my god, this is a ridiculous company and I can't believe people throw money at it. The main point, she and her company are in the news because she has decided to settle a lawsuit in California. According to the BBC, Goop claimed its jade and rose quartz eggs, which are inserted vaginally, could balance hormones and regulate menstrual cycles, among other things. And California had an issue with this, saying that it was misleading. And specifically, District Attorney Jeff Rosen said, the health and money of Santa Clara County residents should never be put at risk by misleading advertising. We will vigilantly protect consumers against companies that promise health benefits without the support of good science. Dot, dot, dot. Or any science. And despite the company agreeing to settle for $145,000, Goop issued a statement saying, while we believe there is an honest disagreement about these claims, the company wanted to settle this matter quickly and amicably. This settlement does not indicate any liability on Goop's part. And actually, those eggs in question, they're still up for sale on this site for $55 and $66. But there are also restrictions with this settlement. Goop can't sell medical devices that are falsely advertised or unapproved, and they're prohibited from making further health claims that are not backed by science. So there's that, and I'll just add a personal note here. If you buy anything from Goop, I think less of you as a human being. They non-ironically sell things like Chill Child, Kid Calming Mist, said to contain a blend of sonically tuned gem elixirs, and tiny Reiki-charged crystals. It also smells incredible. It goes great with their psychic vampire repellent. It's apparently reported to banish bad vibes. But also keep in mind, this is nowhere even close to the most ridiculous, crazy stuff that they promote and or sell. But that's where I'm gonna leave it because I wanna reserve a good chunk of the time for something more important. Then in massive recall news, we had Ford recalling 2 million Ford F-150s. This because according to the company, some pretensioners in front seat belts could generate excessive sparks when deployed, resulting possibly in a fire. And if you're wondering, what did you just say? As Reuters explains, the mechanism of the pretensioner, which works in tandem with airbags, involves an explosive charge that locks the seatbelt in place during a crash. So, not the best thing if you get into a crash and one of the things that is meant to save your life can catch on fire. So there you go, now you know, I saved a life, I'm a hero. And then let's talk about the massive and historic news coming out of India. Now, the core of the problem and issue that we're talking about today is something called Section 377 of India's Penal Code. And Section 377 goes way back. This thing is a relic. It's from British colonial rule in 1861. But it's effectively been unchanged for the last 157 years. And as far as, okay, what is Section 377? It outlawed, quote, carnal intercourse against the order of nature with any man, woman, or animal. And over time, that was widely interpreted as banning oral and anal sex and was punishable by up to 10 years in prison. And while that interpretation doesn't sound like it specifically targets LGBT people, any number of consenting adults can put any number of things in any number of places, the overwhelming majority of people who had charges against them under 377 were gay men. And this is something that India's Supreme Court has addressed before. In 2009, the Delhi High Court gave a decision that ruled Section 377 unconstitutional. But then in 2013, that case was seen by the Supreme Court, who overturned the Delhi High Court decision, meaning that Section 377 was banned. The Supreme Court at that time reasoned that only, quote, a minuscule fraction of the country's population constitute lesbians, gays, bisexuals, or transgenders, and saying that it was legally unsustainable to repeal 377. And following this, unsurprisingly, you had LGBT activists who were very furious about the decision, but also conservative lawmakers and politicians, please. Some like Subramanian Swamy from the BJP saying that a repeal of Section 377 is, quote, a danger to national security and against Hindutva. But in 2017, we saw some progress thanks to the Supreme Court issuing a new ruling dealing with an individual's right to privacy. They ruled in 2017 that sexual orientation is a privacy matter and thus shouldn't be subject to certain laws on privacy grounds. And so this removes some of the power of Section 377, which then brings us to today, where India's Supreme Court unanimously voted to overturn Section 377 after it agreed to a petition that asked the court to revisit their 2013 decision. And when presenting the court's decision, you had Chief Justice Deepak Misra saying, consensual sex between adults in a private space which is not harmful to women or children cannot be denied as it is a matter of individual choice. Section 377 results in discrimination and is violative of constitutional principles. And adding that no one can escape from their individuality. We have to bid adieu to prejudices and empower all citizens. And following this, obviously a ton of people were excited, people celebrating outside of the courthouse and in major cities throughout the country. I think it's just a great thing. Like, something I say constantly on this show is, as long as you're not hurting anybody else, it's between consenting adults, I don't care what you do. You do you. But also a note that I want to hit on is that even though this is a big celebration in India, India, 377 isn't unique to India's penal code. Other former British colonies have them, in fact, 42 in total. And of those, only Australia, Fiji, Hong Kong, New Zealand, and now India have repealed their versions of the law. But from that, I want to share some stuff I love today, and today in Austin, brought to you by BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. And BetterHelp, if you don't know, is the fantastic place and service where you can get affordable private online counseling. You get access to licensed, trained, experienced, accredited psychologists right on your computer, your tablet, your phone, your whatever, or actually not your whatever. It's not Skyrim, but yes, on your computer, your tablet, or your phone. And it's incredibly easy to start. All you gotta do is go to BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. You fill out a questionnaire, they match you with a counselor, and you could start counseling today. And as someone that's not only sponsored by BetterHelp, but uses BetterHelp, and I know that I constantly hit on that note, but with a service like this, I think that's incredibly important. I really could not recommend it enough, or at the very least, even just speaking with a mental health care professional. I think that's incredibly important, even if it's just maintenance. But that said, if it sounds like something that's interesting to you, you want to check it out, maybe try it out, just go to BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. And the first bit of awesome, kind of just a random 24-hour flash sale. If you've been wanting to snag one of our awesome and comfy sports tees, our Stay Humble Hustle Hard tees, for the next 24 hours, if you go there by going to ShopDeFranco.com or just clicking the links in the description down below, use coupon code, one second, gotta come up with it, code GOOP, you will get 15% off. And also, here's a secret, that code may also work for other products in the store, okay, bye now. Why'd I say bye? I'm continuing with the next piece of awesome. Then we got a trailer for American Horror Story Apocalypse. It's Ariana Grande and Jimmy Fallon putting out a sketch around her hair. Did Life Noggin asking what removing parts of your brain will do to you? Spoiler alert, probably not great things. Then we had Eddie Wong on Hot Ones. We got the How It Should Have Ended, but this time not for a movie that's already been released, but for the trailer of Venom. We had Liza Koshy, Markiplier, Rhett Link, and Hannah Hart answering YouTube creator questions from Twitter. Then we got a trailer for the Battle Royale mode for Black Ops 4. And I will say, personally, I'm excited because I like the concept of Battle Royale, but I'm garbage at pretty much every other shooter game except COD. So I'm down and excited to test. And if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, really anything at all, links as always are in the description down below. And then let's talk about the continuing hearings for Supreme Court Justice nominee Brett Kavanaugh. Now, as we covered earlier this week, the hearing in front of the Senate Judiciary Committee started on Tuesday. It began with Democrats trying to adjourn the meeting before it began, multiple protesters interrupting the process. And this was said to be largely because tens of thousands of documents from Kavanaugh's work as an appeals court judge and White House lawyer during the George W. Bush administration were only given to senators the night before the hearings began, which made it virtually impossible to review all the records beforehand, according to Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer. But despite the interruptions, despite the attempts to delay the hearing moved forward, and yesterday senators began questioning Kavanaugh on a range of issues. Now, the hearing lasted for more than 13 hours, so we're going to only focus on a few key moments. And first up, we have assault weapons. One of Kavanaugh's most revealing answers involved a question from California Democratic Senator Dianne Feinstein, who asked him about his views on guns and assault weapons. And this is a key issue for Kavanaugh because as a judge on the D.C. Court of Appeals, he was involved in a case that would have overturned D.C.'s ban on semi-automatic rifles. In Kavanaugh's dissenting opinion, he argued that semi-automatic rifles have not traditionally been banned and are in common use by law-abiding citizens for self-defense in the home, hunting, and other lawful uses. And so when asked about this decision, Kavanaugh highlighted a previous 2008 Supreme Court case called Heller v. D.C., which ultimately held that the city could not ban traditional handguns, but could still ban dangerous and unusual weapons. And he talked about how that decision influenced his reasoning with the case that was before him.
And I concluded that it could not be distinguished as a matter of law, semi-automatic rifles from semi-automatic handguns, and semi-automatic rifles are widely possessed in the United States. There are millions and millions and millions of semi-automatic rifles that are possessed, so that seemed to fit common use and not being a dangerous and unusual weapon.
And then comes the topic of abortion. In another exchange between Feinstein and Kavanaugh, she asked him about his views on abortion, and specifically Roe v. Wade, which legalized abortion in 1973 and was reaffirmed in 1993 thanks to Planned Parenthood v. Casey.
Have your views about whether Roe is settled precedent changed since you were in the Bush White House?
Well, I'll tell you what my views, I'm not sure what it's referring to about Bush White House, but I will tell you what my view right now is, which is an important precedent of the Supreme Court that's been reaffirmed many times, but then and this is the point I want to make that I think is important, Planned Parenthood versus Casey reaffirmed Roe and did so by considering the stare decisis factors. So Casey now becomes a precedent on precedent.
And Kavanaugh's view on abortion are of particular interest because of a case he was involved in called Azar v. Garza. In this case, the D.C. court ruled that an undocumented teenager had the right to get an abortion. But Kavanaugh argued that she needed parental consent, saying the decision was, quote, based on a constitutional principle as novel as it is wrong, a new right for unlawful immigrant minors in U.S. government detention to obtain immediate abortion on demand. And Kavanaugh was asked about his dissent in this case by Democratic Hawaii Senator Mazie Hirono.
First of all, the government did not argue in that case that aliens lack constitutional right generally to obtain an abortion.
Yeah, even they didn't argue it because probably they figured that that's that is a decided issue, but maybe you don't think so. Do you think that that is an open question as to whether or not alien minors or, in fact, aliens in our country have a right to a constitutional right to an abortion? Do you think that is an open case?
The Supreme Court has recognized that persons in the United States have constitutional rights.
Then we had the Trump-related things, presidential subpoenas, the Mueller investigation, and yet another tense exchange between Feinstein and Kavanaugh. He was asked about presidential subpoenas. And this would be extremely relevant to the Mueller investigation, as it remains to be seen whether Mueller, who is of course investigating potential ties between the 2016 Trump campaign and Russia, can legally force Trump to sit down and answer questions. And in his answer, Kavanaugh discussed the 1974 U.S. v. Nixon case, where the Supreme Court ordered President Nixon to turn over secret recordings he made related to Watergate. And also he highlighted the Ginsburg rule, which highlights the fact that Justice Ginsburg refused to answer pointed questions about speculative future Supreme Court ruling.
Can a sitting president be required to respond to a subpoena?
So that's a hypothetical question about what would be an elaboration or a difference from U.S. v. Nixon's precise holding.
That's right.
And I think going with the Justice Ginsburg principle, which is really not the Justice Ginsburg alone principle, it's everyone's principle on the current Supreme Court. And as a matter of the canons of judicial independence, I can't give you an answer on that hypothetical question.
On the same note of Donald Trump and the investigation surrounding his administration, you had Vermont Democratic Senator Patrick Leahy asking Kavanaugh this question.
Trump claims he has an absolute right to pardon himself, does he?
The question of self-pardons is something I've never analyzed. It's a question that I've not written about. It's a question, therefore, that's a hypothetical question that I can't begin to answer in this context as a sitting judge and as a nominee to the Supreme
Court. And the other half of that is the obvious one. Does the president have the ability to pardon somebody in exchange for a promise from that person they wouldn't testify against him?
Sarah, I'm not going to answer hypothetical questions.
But it's also important to note that we saw this interaction between Kavanaugh and Nebraska Republican Senator Ben Sasse.
Is the president immune from either being sued or being charged with a crime because they're president?
No one has ever said, I don't think, that the president is immune from civil or criminal process. So immunity is the wrong term to even think about in this process. The only question that's ever been debated is whether the actual process should occur while still in office. That's the Jones v. Clinton case, where strong arguments were presented by both sides, and the Supreme Court ultimately decided that the civil process could go forward against President Clinton. President Clinton was arguing that the civil process should be deferred until after he left office. The Supreme Court rejected that. So, too, the only question with the criminal process is not immunity. That's the wrong term. It's timing. And as I said, the Justice Department for 45 years has taken the position that the timing of the criminal process, a criminal process, should be after the president leaves office.
In addition to this, there was also an odd exchange between Democratic California Senator Kamala Harris and Kavanaugh. She repeatedly asked him whether he had ever discussed the Mueller investigation with members of a law firm that was headed by one of Trump's former lawyers, which Kavanaugh said he could not remember. But a big note here, while it was weird, so far Harris hasn't provided any evidence or documentation of her insinuation. So right now, many are wondering what is the exact reason behind why she pushed so hard on this specific issue. And then today, things started getting spicy. We get email leaks, challenges, potential lying during testimony. But I'll start at the top of this craziness. Today, we had the New York Times releasing leaked committee confidential emails from an anonymous source relating to Kavanaugh's past as a White House lawyer during the Bush administration. And committee confidential means that senators with access to these documents are not supposed to discuss them or make them public. And the documents we see here were marked confidential by Bill Burke, who is a former lawyer for President George W. Bush and has represented multiple Trump White House officials in the Mueller investigation, which has raised questions about the impartiality of this nomination process. And the most significant of these first leaked emails is from March of 2003, and it involves Kavanaugh Kavanaugh's correspondence about a draft opinion piece that was written to support one of George W. Bush's appeals court nominees. And this piece was supposed to be written and placed under the names of anti-abortion women. With it, Kavanaugh proposed deleting a line from the draft that read, "It is widely accepted by legal scholars across the board that Roe v. Wade and its progeny are the settled law of the land." And according to that email he wrote, "I am not sure that all legal scholars refer to Roe as the settled law of the land at the Supreme Court level, since court can always overrule its precedent, and three current justices on the court would do so. The point there is in the inferior court point." And this is something that was actually referred to by Democratic Senator Richard Blumenthal yesterday. He asked, "Did you take this position, the one that was expressed in this email?" Which he said, "Some legal scholars have said that over time," but then separating himself from that by saying,
"That's different from what I, as a judge, my position as a judge is that there's 45 years of precedent, and there's Planned Parenthood versus Casey, which reaffirmed Roe, so that's precedent on precedent, as I've explained, and that's important."
But in a press conference today, Blumenthal accused Kavanaugh of misleading the Judiciary Committee on his views on Roe. Also this morning, Senator Cory Booker stated in the hearing that he would release confidential documents not available to the public. And he said he was doing so because none of the withheld documents actually had anything to do with national security. And then Booker seemingly made good on that promise, releasing the documents on Twitter, writing, "These are the four documents marked committee confidential that I brought up in my questioning of Supreme Court nominee Brett Kavanaugh last night." And the documents included emails regarding Kavanaugh's views on racial profiling, affirmative action, and other race-related government programs. In one email from 2001, Kavanaugh discusses a legal challenge to an affirmative action policy at the Department of Transportation, writing, "The fundamental problem in this case is that these DOT regulations use a lot of legalisms and disguises to mask what in reality is a naked racial set-aside." In another email from 2002 about racial profiling, Kavanaugh wrote, "The people who favor some use of race slash national origin obviously do not need to grapple with the interim question. But the people such as you and I, who generally favor effective security measures that are race neutral, in fact, do need to grapple, and grapple now with the interim question of what to do before a truly effective and comprehensive race-neutral system is developed and implemented." And quickly after that, we saw other Democratic senators support Booker. Senator Mazie Hirono released a committee confidential document on Twitter, writing, "These are the docs ours don't want you to see, because they show that Judge Kavanaugh wrongly believes that Native Hawaiian programs are constitutionally questionable. I defy anyone reading this to be able to conclude that it should be deemed confidential in any way, shape, or form." We also saw Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer release a statement this morning saying, "I stand with Judiciary Committee Democrats who are well within their rights to release these very important documents that a former Kavanaugh deputy designed as committee confidential. The American people deserve to know the truth about Judge Kavanaugh's record. Hashtag, what are they hiding?" And that last part is one of the most interesting questions about all of this. Because even if these emails being released, they do not contain bombshells, it does not seem like they were withheld for national security reasons. So why would non-bombshell documents be marked committee confidential? Right, and so there's generally two arguments here. One, maybe they were worried that some of this makes Kavanaugh not look so great. Or two, if there are actual bombshell documents around Kavanaugh, if you are supporting Kavanaugh, you want to defend him, it is in your best interest to make the haystack that this needle is in as large as possible. Now, unsurprisingly, there were a lot of people not really happy with Booker. Did Senator Cornyn, referring to Booker's actions as irresponsible and outrageous, continuing,
"No senator deserves to sit on this committee or serve in the Senate, in my view, if they decide to be a law unto themselves and willingly flout the rules of the Senate and the determination of confidentiality and classification."
Cornyn then going on to read the rules on publicly disclosing Senate documents, to which Booker responded, bring it.
"For contempt.
Bring it.
So I would
bring it."
But then after the exchange between Booker and Cornyn, Cornyn tweeted out, "Turns out it is already cleared for public viewing." And reportedly right after, the Judiciary Committee released the racial profiling emails as part of a larger 93-page release. And so now there's this debate over whether what Booker did was a false grandstand. Bill Burke, who led the review of Kavanaugh's records, releasing a statement saying, "We cleared the documents last night shortly after Senator Booker's staff asked us to. We were surprised to learn about Senator Booker's histrionics this morning because we had already told him he could use the documents publicly. In fact, we have said yes to every request made by the Senate Democrats to make documents public." But then Booker's team issued the statement, "Cory and Senate Democrats were able to shame the committee into agreeing to make last night's documents publicly available, and Cory publicly released those documents as well as other committee confidential documents today," and adding that he'll keep releasing them. So we have that, but main point, it appears that someone is lying here. So there was that situation. Also, as far as Booker actually being expelled, I don't know if that would actually happen. And the reason I say that is it appears that no senator has actually been expelled since 1862. And that was an extreme case because that involved members expressing their support for the Confederate States during the Civil War. And also, most other senators that faced expulsion either resigned or just were not expelled. And then finally, oh my goodness, it's almost over. If you think this is long, imagine scrubbing through it. Prominent Democrats are now alleging that Kavanaugh may have lied about something he testified about in 2004. And what they're talking about is in 2004, Kavanaugh testified that he did not not personally handle the nomination of a judicial candidate named William Pryor, who is now a judge on the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals, who was nominated by President George W. Bush. And Pryor, if you don't know, is also a former Attorney General of Alabama, and is widely seen as a controversial figure because of some of the views he has regarding the treatment of prisoners, as well as sodomy laws. He previously defended Alabama's practice of handcuffing inmates to posts if they refused to work on chain gangs, and kind of an unexpected crossover, he argued that states should be able to protect the, quote, moral standards of their communities through legislation that prohibits homosexual sodomy. And according to more emails that have just been made public, Kavanaugh may have actually been more involved in Pryor's nomination process than he let on during his 2004 testimony. One of the emails he wrote in 2003 saying, "We need to discuss nominee Bill Pryor's hearing next Wednesday," and in response to an email to him asking how the Pryor interview went, he replied, "Call me." But trying to counter this point, you had Raj Shah, Deputy White House Press Secretary, tweeting, "Judge Kavanaugh accurately said he was not the handler within the White House of Judge Pryor's nomination. Another White House attorney handled the nomination." In that same testimony, he acknowledged that he might have been involved in some prep meetings, including testimony from Kavanaugh saying, "I don't remember preparing for his testimony on that subject. I might have attended a moot court session. Oftentimes, we will go to moot courts to prepare nominees for hearings, prepare them for this process." You also have people arguing that doesn't line up with everything we're seeing in the emails. But that's where we are with the situation right now. I mean, this is still a developing story, so we will be keeping our eye on it. And as far as my personal takeaway from the situation, other than the Democrats through these emails being able to prove that Kavanaugh broke the law, the rest of this is all a show. And I don't mean that it's fake. I just mean that it's posturing going into the midterms and then 2020. Unless the mother of all bombs gets dropped, Kavanaugh's getting through. These people have had their votes locked. You think that any of the people asking questions are going to hear something and go like, "Oh, I never thought of it that way. You've changed my mind now." No, this is a party line situation. It might not be right. It might not be the way things should be done, but it is where we are currently. And that is where I'm gonna end this story and pass the question off to you. What is your takeaway from all of this? I know there's a lot, some of the key points, the situation as a whole, any and all things I'd love to see down below. And that's where we're going to end today's show. But of course, remember, I always want these videos to be a conversation too, so whether it be the last story, the first one, anything in between, let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. Also, while you're at it, if you like getting these daily news videos, hit that like button. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button. Also, remember, if you missed this morning's extra bonus news video, you can click or tap right there. Or if you missed yesterday's regular Philip DeFranco show, you can click or tap there. But that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.